Dr. Feigl-Ding, let's talk about bird flu. What is bird flu, and why should? And then, secondly, why should we be concerned about it?
Right, and bird flu is also known as H5N1. There's other types of bird flu, but this specific bird flu that's called highly pathogenic avian influenza is what's spreading like wildfire. It's spread worldwide. It's killed off like scores, like we're talking about millions of birds and other wildlife around the world, walruses, many. It's infected almost every species. And in terms of in the U.S., it's infected many cattle herds. And the USDA was very slow reacting to this. But basically, cattle herds across the majority of the U.S. states have had it, especially almost every single Western state by now. Mm-hmm. So, and the other worrisome thing is that is milk, because it's highly concentrated in milk. And if you drink raw milk, it has active bird flu in it.
Yikes.
And even, by the way, in pastures, even studies of the pasteurization, like unless it's ultra pasteurized, there's actually like three studies that show regular flash pasture, the short period, fast pasteurization that's mostly used, actually does not fully kill the virus either. The virus does still survive and is still infectious afterwards. But ultra-pasteurized is safest. But definitely don't drink raw milk. And there's a lot of recalls in California right now about raw milk and being infected. And, you know, they've, for example, in farms, they've cats that drank the raw milk from these cows have had really, really severe consequences and deaths in cats that drank this milk. So definitely don't drink the raw milk. Humans, there's been a wide number of infections and hospitalizations, but in North America, the most serious one, there's last month there was a teenager in Vancouver that was infected, and he was hospitalized, was in the ICU. And that one case was interesting because there was no, the child had no bird exposure, does not work at a zoo or a farm whatsoever. So they actually don't know where that child, that teenager exactly got bird flu. In the U.S., we've had a lot of farmers who've been infected. But in terms of hospitalization, the first hospitalization was reported, I think, a couple of days ago in Louisiana. There was a Louisiana man who was hospitalized, but that person was a poultry farmer.
Right. So far, these have all been animal-to-human transmissions. Isn't the big concern?
Animal-to-human. Although, except for the Vancouver case and the teenager, they could not find the source.
Right. I can tell you, I live in the Pacific Northwest, and there is goose poop and duck poop on every sidewalk everywhere. I mean, it's pretty ubiquitous here. But in any case, isn't the big concern that a human or a pig or some other animal infected with a normal flu virus that's capable of infecting humans will also be infected with bird flu, and they'll mix genes and suddenly the bird flu will jump? This is what happened in 1918, isn't it?
Right. It's called chimera, basically when two viruses combine, or two sister viruses, or two different viruses entirely, and you can get a worst of both worlds situation because a single patient or animal that is co-infected with both can mix in between, and the viruses can swap genes. And during that gene swapping process, you can have a whole host of bad combinations that comes out of it. Like, you know, a milder virus that's more infectious, like the traditional flu, might pass some of its more infectious genes to the bird flu. And the bird flu, you know, which up until now has not been human to human as much, may pick up that. And there's studies that show that we're basically only one or two mutations away from the bird flu being highly infectious in humans. Right. Because there's, in terms of transmission, like it has to be stable beyond just, you know, milk, for example, mm-hmm. For it to be like airborne.
Right.
There's genes that make a virus more stable in the air. Mm-hmm. And then there's also genes that make it much more effective in terms of like key and lock system for it to infect a human cell.
Right.
And this lock and key system, if it mutates and gains these certain mutations, and we're only about one or two mutations away, then it can effectively infect human cells.
But this is a deadly virus, is it not? I mean, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. In birds especially. And humans, there has been like dozens of deaths in other countries. The U.S., we haven't had a death yet. Yeah. But we've had many farmers infected. You know, there are hospitalizations. And I think this is where it hasn't reached an epic tipping point in humans yet. But cattle herds, avian poultry, bird, you know, turkey, chicken populations, they've been
definitely hit. Oh, this is why eggs are so expensive right now, yeah. We just have a minute left before we hit a hard break. In 1918, we did not have a flu vaccine. We do now. Should that provide us with some solace?
Yeah, we do have flu vaccines, but it's not the bird flu vaccine. So you should definitely get your annual seasonal flu vaccine, but that is not bird flu vaccine. And the bird flu vaccine, we do have limited quantities in the U.S. stockpile, but not mass-produced. And that bird flu vaccine is an older strain. It's not tailored to the latest. It's better than nothing, but they haven't even released it. There was debates about releasing it, but it's not. But I would say there's no over-the-counter test for bird flu, but bird flu is a type of flu A. And there are tests available out there where you can test, because it's so similar, whether it's COVID, flu A, or flu B.
Right.
If you get a flu A positive, it doesn't mean it's bird flu, but bird flu would show up under one of these flu A tests that's out there.
Dr. Feigl-Ding, thank you so much for dropping by. We really appreciate your coming on this program. Thank you.
Thank you. Stay safe.
Yeah, you too, and happy holidays.